Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. First, a quick update on Katowice Climate Summit video. We are facing some issues with the video. As soon as these technical glitches are resolved, we shall upload the video. Please bear with us for a few more days. Now let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper, beginning with some of the editorials and columns. And the first one, The Danger of Reciprocity, written by Faizan Mustafa. What is the context? Recently, two judges have been appointed to the Supreme Court, Justice Sanjeev Khanna and Justice Dinesh Maheshwari. These names were recommended by the Supreme Court Collegium. The government accepted these recommendations. These two judges were sworn in and appointed to the Supreme Court. But then came a controversy. The controversy was that in the list of seniority, there were judges senior to these two judges, but these senior judges have been overlooked and two junior judges have been appointed as the judges of the Supreme Court. And critics quickly compared this development with something that happened in the case of Justice K.M. Joseph. Justice K.M. Joseph was the Chief Justice of Uttarakhand High Court when the Uttarakhand High Court quashed the imposition of President's rule in the state of Uttarakhand. Then Justice K.M. Joseph was recommended by the Supreme Court Collegium to the Supreme Court. The government returned the name of Justice K.M. Joseph and asked the Supreme Court Collegium to please reconsider the name. Why? Because on the question of seniority. The government argued that in the list of seniority, there are judges senior to Justice K.M. Joseph, but these senior judges have been overlooked and a junior judge, K.M. Joseph, has been recommended for the Supreme Court. But when the Supreme Court Collegium recommended the name of Justice K.M. Joseph again, the government had no other option but to appoint K.M. Joseph as the judge of the Supreme Court. Critics are arguing that in the case of K.M. Joseph, his name was sent back by the government. But today, when these two junior judges have been recommended by the Supreme Court Collegium to the government is not returning these two names to the Supreme Court Collegium for reconsideration. That means this time, the government not only did not return the recommendation to the Collegium for reconsideration, but approved the appointments instantly. This, Faizan Mustafa says, raises the danger of reciprocity. Because if the judges of the day owe their appointments or their judicial existence to the executive, then what will happen? Judiciary as an institution will be compromised. The independence of judiciary will be compromised. Because if this executive has favored the judge, how will the judge reciprocate? The judge will reciprocate by favoring the executive. And in this process, the violation of separation of powers will be complete. Faizan Mustafa quotes a very famous American sociologist, Alvin Goldner. Alvin Goldner has articulated the norm of reciprocity when he says that people should help those who have helped them and people should not injure those who have helped them. So if this executive has helped a judge, this judge will reciprocate by helping the executive. And that is why the appointment of judges to the judiciary should be insulated from the executive pressure. And that is why Faizan Mustafa argues it is vital that Supreme Court Collegium remains firmly independent. But there is a problem with Supreme Court Collegium as well. Please watch this lecture carefully towards the end. We will discuss and critically analyze the role of the Supreme Court Collegium. In today's mains question, we will discuss the evolution of the Supreme Court Collegium and critically analyze it. Now let's look at another column on page number 6 of the Delhi edition of The Hindu. Some call it democracy. This is related to the sedition law. JNU students have been charge-sheeted under the sedition law. And this sedition law is something that we discussed in our 15th January Hindu newspaper analysis. We talked about the evolution of sedition law, the provisions of this law, various Supreme Court rulings on this law, and we also talked about why sedition law should be removed from the statute books. If you have not watched that analysis, please go through that analysis, then you don't need to read this newspaper article. Because this newspaper article justifies the removal of sedition law from the statute books. There is an editorial in today's newspaper, Nudged into Action. and that talks about the recent Supreme Court push to establish Lokpal in this country. And my colleague in yesterday's newspaper analysis has explained this Supreme Court ruling in detail. Please go through that newspaper analysis if you have not. Now let's look at some of the news in brief. Beginning with a news on page number 3, it talks about Great Indian Bustard. Now there are four bustard species. One is the Great Indian Bustard. The other we have Lesser Florican. Then we have Bengal Florican. And then we have Hobara Bustard. This Hobara Bustard is basically a migratory species. If you look at this Great Indian Bustard, it is one of the heaviest flying birds. And the IUCN status of this Great Indian Bustard is critically endangered. But now let's look at some of the details of this Great Indian Bustard. The first detail that is very important from your prelims point of view is that this Great Indian Bustard can be easily distinguished because of its black crown. Look at the black crown. And this black crown contrasts with the pale neck and pale head. That's detail number one. Detail number two, the male and female Great Indian Bustard, they generally grow to the same height, same weight. But there is one distinguishing character that distinguishes male from female. And that is that this male Great Indian Bustard, its black crown is slightly larger than the female Great Indian Bustard. That is how you can distinguish a male and a female Great Indian Bustard. But what are the threats to this Great Indian Bustard? The biggest threat is hunting. If you're reading newspaper articles closely, you would have noticed that there are wealthy sheikhs from Saudi, Dubai, UAE and other Gulf states. They travel to Pakistan where they hunt these Great Indian Bustards because these Great Indian Bustards are found in Pakistan as well. So the biggest threat is hunting. Second, they collide with high tension electric wires. That is another threat to these Great Indian Bustards. The third threat, they die due to accidents involving fast-moving vehicles. The fourth threat is the mining and industrialization. And this mining and industrialization is also leading to the habitat loss. There was a time when Great Indian Bustards, they were found in 11 states in India. Now there are only 5 states in India where these Great Indian Bustards are naturally found. And one such state is Rajasthan. And in Rajasthan, Great Indian Bustard is the state bird. Another important detail regarding Great Indian Bustard is that once it was considered as a top contender to be declared as India's national bird. But this Great Indian Bustard may soon become extinct because only 50 Great Indian Bustards are left in the wild and there is no action plan to save them. That is what you need to understand from this newspaper article. Now there is another newspaper article on page number 5, Rural Housing Achieves Only 66% Target. Now Prime Minister Modi has a goal and that goal is called Housing for All. And under this Housing for All, we have two schemes running, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, that is in urban India, and Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, that is in rural India. So far as this rural housing component is concerned, it has achieved only 66% target. And the center has pinned the blame on the states. Because center says that the states are delaying the allotment of land for these landless beneficiaries. Let's look at two MCQs that you need to know regarding Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. First is, with reference to Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Grameen, which of the following statements are incorrect? It is implemented by Ministry of Panchayati Raj, wrong. The cost of unit assistance is to be shared between central and state governments in the ratio of 60:40 for all states. This statement is also wrong. So the correct answer is C because both these statements are wrong. What is the explanation? This scheme is implemented by Ministry of Rural Development. That's number one. And under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, the cost of unit assistance to construct these homes, This cost of unit assistance is to be shared between central and state governments in the ratio of 60:40, but that too in any other state except which are in Northeast India and the hilly states. For states in Northeastern India and the hilly states, the ratio is 90:10. That means 90% funds will be allocated by the central government, 10% funds are to be borne by the state governments. Let's look at another MCQ. Consider the following statements regarding Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban. It is undertaken by Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation. Correct? The credit-linked subsidy is implemented as a central-sponsored scheme. Wrong. Beneficiaries include economically weaker sections only. Wrong. The houses constructed should be in the name of both husband and the wife. This statement is also wrong. So which of the above statements are correct? Only one. What is the explanation? Beneficiaries include economically weaker sections as well, low-income groups as well, middle-income groups as well. And the annual income cap is 3 lakhs for economically weaker sections of the society. Those whose annual household income is 3 to 6 lakh, they come under lower income group. They are also eligible under this scheme. And those whose annual household income is above 6 lakhs and up to 18 lakhs, they come under middle income group. And they are also eligible under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. And this mission is implemented as a centrally sponsored scheme except for the component of credit-linked subsidy. Because this credit-linked subsidy is to be implemented as a central sector scheme. But what is the difference between central sector scheme and centrally sponsored scheme? In this central sector scheme, it is 100% funded by the central government. It is also implemented by the central government. But if it's a centrally sponsored scheme, then a certain percentage of funding is borne by the states. For example, for certain centrally sponsored schemes, the funding is 50:50. 50 will be borne by the center, 50 by the states. Some are 70:30. Some 90:10. For example, 90 will be borne by the center, 10 will be borne by the states. But so far as central sector scheme is concerned, 100% implementation as well as funding is borne by the central government. And these houses should be in the name of female head of the household or in the joint name of both husband as well as the wife. Or when there is no adult female, then in that cases, house can be in the name of male member of the household. That is what you need to understand from this newspaper article. Now let's look at another news on page number 18. Saturn's rings are younger than thought. Astronomers thought that these rings were developed soon after Saturn was formed, which is some 4.5 billion years ago. But now they think that these rings are younger than thought, and they were formed between 100 million and 10 million years ago. But how do we know about this? This is based on the measurements of the planet Saturn that were collected by Cassini. And what is this Cassini-Huygens mission? It was a collaboration between NASA, European Space Agency and Italian Space Agency. And this mission was sent to study Saturn along with its rings as well as satellites. Another important detail for your prelims, in 2017, this mission ended. When this probe, it made a controlled entry into Saturn. But there are a few details regarding Saturn that you need to understand from the prelims point of view. Details such as Saturn is the sixth planet of our solar system from the Sun. Second, it is the second largest planet in our solar system after the planet Jupiter. Third, there are 62 known moons in Saturn. And the largest moon is Titan. And the second largest moon on Saturn is Rhea. That is what you need to understand from this newspaper article. Let's look at some of the prelims-based questions. Arrange the following passes from north to south. Deepu Pass, Komjang Pass, Hoopgang Pass, Pangsau Pass, Chokam Pass. And the correct answer is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, B. And this is the explanation. Map-based question. Nidanthivu Island, recently seen in news, it's in Sri Lanka. What is the context? Recently, four Tamil fishermen were arrested by the Sri Lankan Navy for allegedly fishing off this island. Previous year's prelims-based question 2018, which of the following leaf modifications occur in desert areas to inhibit water loss? Hard and waxy leaves, yes. Tiny leaves, yes. Thorns instead of leaves, yes. Correct answer, 1, 2, 3, D. Now let's look at the mains-based question. The Collegium system of judicial appointments needs an urgent relook in the light of recent controversies comment. Let's look at the origin of this Collegium system. If you look at Article 124 of Indian Constitution, Constitution says that every judge of the Supreme Court shall be appointed by the President. And while appointing judges to the Supreme Court, the President shall consult such of the judges of the Supreme Court and High Court as he may deem necessary. But Constitution further says, if a judge to the Supreme Court is to be appointed other than the Chief Justice of India, then the President shall consult Chief Justice of India as well. Constitution further talks about the appointment of a High Court judge. Constitution says that a High Court judge shall be appointed by the President after consultation with the Chief Justice of India, and the President shall also consult the Governor of the state. This is how original Constitution talked about the appointment of judges. If a judge other than the Chief Justice of India is to be appointed, President shall consult such of the judges of the Supreme Court and High Court as he may deem necessary. But Chief Justice of India should also be consulted. But if a judge to a High Court is to be appointed, then the President shall consult the Governor of that state as well, Chief Justice of India as well, Chief Justice of that High Court as well. In the initial decades of our Republic, we were following a convention. The convention was that a senior-most judge of the Supreme Court is appointed as Chief Justice of India. And while appointing judges other than the Chief Justice of India, the Chief Justice of India was always consulted. But then we violated this convention when in 1973, Justice A.N. Ray was appointed as the Chief Justice of India, and in the list of seniority, Justice A.N. Ray was at serial number 4. And why Justice A.N. Ray was appointed as the Chief Justice of India, superseding three senior judges of the Supreme Court? Because in 1970, Justice A.N. Ray sided with the government of the day when the judges were hearing the bank nationalization case. And if Justice A.N. Ray favored the government in 1970, the government favored Justice A.N. Ray in 1973 by appointing A.N. Ray as the Chief Justice of India. Then what happened? These three judges, they resigned in protest. Then came a landmark case in 1976, habeas corpus case or ADM Jabalpur case. In this case, five judges had to decide whether habeas corpus can be suspended during emergency or not. Four judges said, yes, habeas corpus can be suspended even during the emergency. But one judge, Justice Khanna said, right to life is such an important fundamental right that this right to life cannot be suspended even during the emergency. And even during the emergency, if habeas corpus is filed in the Supreme Court, this habeas corpus cannot be suspended. But since four judges sided with the government, Justice Khanna was the lone dissenting judge on this panel, and Justice Khanna was then the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, and he was all set to be appointed as the Chief Justice of India. But in 1977, he was overlooked. Justice Beg was appointed as the Chief Justice of India, and Justice Khanna, he also resigned in protest. Then came another important case, S.P. Gupta versus Union of India in 1981. And this case is famously called as the first judge's case. In this case, the question was that if the Constitution says that the President shall consult Chief Justice of India, does this consultation mean concurrence? That means if Chief Justice of India says A should not be appointed, B should be appointed, is it binding on the President to appoint B? Or can President go ahead and appoint A instead of B? Supreme Court said consultation does not mean concurrence. That means President should only consult Chief Justice of India. But whatever advice is tendered by Chief Justice of India to the President, it is not binding on the President. Supreme Court further said that a judge of a high court can be transferred from one high court to another high court, even against the will of that judge. But then came another judgment, Supreme Court's Advocates on Records Association versus Union of India 1993. In this case, Supreme Court said consultation is equal to concurrence. That means whatever advice is given by Chief Justice of India to the President, it is binding on the President. But Supreme Court went a step further. Supreme Court said appointing judges to the judiciary is a very important task. And you cannot only consult Chief Justice of India. You have to consult plurality of judges. Supreme Court said that in order to appoint judges to the higher judiciary, the President shall consult Chief Justice of India plus two senior most judges of the Supreme Court, and whatever name is recommended by this collegium, this name is binding on the President. But President may send the name back for reconsideration, but only once. That means if this collegium is recommending the name of aide to be appointed as the judge of the Supreme Court or High Court, President may send the name back for reconsideration, but only once. If the same name is recommended again by the collegium to the government had no other option but to appoint A as the judge of the Supreme Court. This 1993 judgment led to the establishment of a collegium system for judicial appointments. Then came another judgment in 1998, and this was a presidential reference. Because under Article 143 of Indian Constitution, President's advisor is the Supreme Court. Supreme Court is the advisor of the President. President can refer any matter to the Supreme Court, asking the views of the Supreme Court on that matter. And in this case, President referred this matter of appointment of judges to the Supreme Court, asking the views of the Supreme Court on this matter about how judicial appointments can take place. And it is in this third judge's case or 1998 case that Supreme Court widened the scope of this collegium. Supreme Court said that now this collegium shall consist of Chief Justice of India plus four senior most judges of the Supreme Court. And whatever name is recommended by this collegium to the government, it shall be binding of the government. The government may send the name back for reconsideration, but only once. If the same name is recommended again by the collegium, the government has no other option but to appoint that individual. But in this case, Supreme Court further said that Chief Justice of India enjoys primacy in judicial appointments. Supreme Court said that any name, if it is not acceptable to Chief Justice of India, this name cannot be sent to the President for appointment. So that means in judicial appointments, the Chief Justice of India enjoys the virtual veto. And because of these two judgments of 1993 and 1998, India is the only country in the world where judges are appointed by themselves. But this collegium system has been criticized by many. On the grounds, number one, when this collegium verdict was given by the Supreme Court justified it by saying that there are huge vacancies in the high courts and Supreme Courts, and the executive is not proactive in filling up these vacancies, and that is why there is delay in the disposal of justice in this country. So to speed up the filling of these vacancies, we need a collegium system of judicial appointments. But today there are more than 25% vacancies in different high courts in this country. That means if the objective of the collegium system was to speed up the filling of vacancies in the judiciary, they have failed in discharging this duty. Second criticism is that this entire collegium system is opaque. It is not transparent. What do they discuss in these meetings? We don't know. On what grounds do they recommend names to the President for appointment? We don't know. On what parameters do they recommend names to the government for appointment? We don't know. Do they check the constitutional philosophy of these judges before they are recommended to the government for appointment? We don't know. So the entire process lacks transparency. It is all opaque. The other problem is with the composition of this collegium system. Collegium system says that this collegium system shall consist of Chief Justice of India and four senior judges of the Supreme Court. Why are junior judges kept out of this consultation process? Maybe this junior judge is more qualified or more competent than this senior judge. That's another criticism. But the biggest criticism is that this collegium system is unconstitutional. Why is it unconstitutional? Because original constitution does not mention collegium system. Original constitution says that the president shall consult such of the judges of the Supreme Court and High Court as he may deem necessary. Original constitution said that the president shall also consult the governor of the state while appointing judges to the High Court. The governor is not involved in this collegium system at all. That means we can safely say because of 1993 and 1998 judgments, the Supreme Court has amended the Constitution. Supreme Court has amended the Constitution by adding collegium system of judicial appointments. Supreme Court has amended the Constitution by rendering the name of the governor redundant in this entire appointment process. Can Constitution be amended only by the Parliament under Article 368? Or can Constitution be amended by a judicial judgment as well? Then the government decided that we should have NJAC, National Judicial Appointments Commission. Instead of collegium system, what we should have? We should have NJAC. NJAC will consist of Chief Justice of India, two senior judges of the Supreme Court, Law Minister, and two eminent persons. And what is the function that this NJAC will perform? This NJAC will replace the collegium system. That means all the tasks performed by the collegium system will now be performed by NJAC. Many people argued that this is the best way of judicial appointments. In this NJAC, judiciary is also involved, executive is also involved, civil society is also involved, and this is the win-win situation for everybody. But matter went to the court. And in 2015, what is now called as the fourth judge's case, Supreme Court said this NJAC is unconstitutional. Why? Supreme Court said this NJAC violates independence of judiciary. And since independence of judiciary is part of the basic structure of Indian Constitution, NJAC is unconstitutional. Supreme Court added one more item in this list of basic structure, and that was the primacy of Chief Justice of India. Supreme Court said primacy of Chief Justice of India in judicial appointments is also part of the basic structure of Indian Constitution, and that is why NJAC is unconstitutional. Because in this NJAC, Chief Justice of India does not have a primacy. But now let's evaluate whether this NJAC violates the independence of judiciary. If NJAC violates the independence of the judiciary, then the biggest violator of the independence of judiciary is the original Constitution. Because in original constitution, the executive had the sole role in appointment process. Judiciary was only given a consultative role. B.R. Ambedkar, the drafter of our constitution, he said judiciary is the very important institution that we should have. And independence of judiciary should be strengthened at all costs. But even then he said, we should still have checks and balances on the judiciary. And how can we have checks and balances on the judiciary? The appointment will be done by the executive. The removal shall be done by the executive, but based on the resolution passed by the legislature. It is through this appointment and removal process that we can have checks and balances on the judiciary. So the original constitution only gave a consultative role to the judiciary. But what this NJAC did, it not only gave consultative role to judiciary, but also deliberative role. In this NJAC, three members were from the judicial system. So if the original constitution does not violate the independence of judiciary, how can NJAC, which gave more role to the judiciary in judicial appointments, violate the independence of judiciary? But there is something else. How did the original constitution provide an independent character to our judiciary? Through various means. One such is security of tenure. Judges in India are not employees of the government. That means they do not hold office during the pleasure of the president. They hold office till they attain a certain age. That means a Supreme Court judge remains in office till 65 years. a high court judge remains in office till he attains the age of 62. That means they have a security of tenure and they cannot be removed by the president based on the doctrine of pleasure. And this security of tenure was not snatched by NJAC. Number two, the salaries, allowances and pensions of the judges of the Supreme Court are charged on the Consolidated Fund of India. That means they are not subject to the vote of the parliament. That means even if the budget is not passed, the salaries for the judges, the pensions for the judges will still be released to them. That is how independence of judiciary was thought about by the original constitution. And this was not snatched by NJAC. Similarly, inside the parliament, members of the parliament has an absolute freedom of speech and expression. They can say whatever they want to say inside the parliament. And whatever they say inside the parliament, they will not be held accountable in any court of law. That means members of the parliament, they enjoy absolute freedom of speech and expression while they are speaking on the floor of the parliament. But there is only one restriction. They cannot discuss the conduct of judges unless and until a motion calling for their removal is being discussed in the parliament. That means the conduct of judges cannot be discussed even inside the parliament. This was something which was not snatched by NJAC. That means NJAC only tried to recalibrate the process of appointment, which was arrogated by the Supreme Court onto itself. And NJAC only tried to strengthen the doctrine of checks and balances, which is an integral part of our constitution. But the Supreme Court said NJAC is unconstitutional because it violates the independence of judiciary, which is part of the basic structure of Indian constitution. And that is why collegium system has been criticized. But there are others who say that collegium system is a lesser evil. If we have to choose between two evils, one is the complete dominance of the executive in appointment process, and second is the complete dominance of the judiciary in appointments, we should take the lesser evil, and that lesser evil is the collegium system. But even then, the collegium system should be overhauled. There should be transparency in the way in which the discussions are carried out in the collegium system. When Justice Misra was the Chief Justice of India, Justice Misra said that all the decisions taken by the collegium system will be put on the website of the Supreme Court. But the Supreme Court website only gives us the information about the judges who have been appointed. We are still not told what is the thought process that goes into recommending names to the government for judicial appointments. So more transparency, less opacity in judicial appointments is the need of the hour. That is it from our newspaper analysis today. Thank you for being with us. Have a great day.